On this edition of Independent Sources, an effort to change the face of community boards in the city.
I help out in this community, I volunteer in this community, and this is one of the first places I started to work when I first graduated from college, so I felt I had a vested interest in being a part of Community Board 8.
And a few community college students embark on a magical journey of a lifetime.
These kids from the Bronx are now in Scotland performing this play. It was just amazing. And the fact that Hostos doesn't have a theater department. So these students, they don't have any theater background except for me.
Those stories and more coming up on Independent Sources. Welcome to Independent Sources. I'm Garry Pierre-Pierre. A new wave of younger New Yorkers are finding their way onto local community boards in the city. Some of them are new immigrants, while others are second generation. This week, Zyphus LeBrun will speak to Stony Brook University Associate Professor Seth Foreman about how these community boards can often be crucial to understanding local government and act as springboards that launch political careers. But before that, Mengling Wang profiles an African immigrant who is trying to bring his voice to the table.
On first glance, you would not think that this man sitting here is a member of a local community board in Brooklyn. But he's one of the wave of young people get involved throughout the city.
My name is Adam Bunkadeko. I'm 25 years old. I currently work at the Empire State Development Corporation. I'm a member of Community Board 8. And I currently live in Crown Heights, Brooklyn. I was involved actively within the community throughout. I was a member at the Bedford-Stuyvesant Restoration Corporation. I started to attend some of the meetings at Community Board 8 and decided it might be worth joining. I live in this community, I help out in this community, I volunteer in this community, and this is one of the first places I started to work when I first graduated from college, so I felt I had a vested interest in being a part of Community Board 8.
Community District 8 in Brooklyn consists of Crown Heights, Prospect Heights, and Wicksville. More than one-fifth of the population is between 18 and 29 years old. However, Bunkadeko is the only person in his 20s at the board where he serves.
The community in Community Board 8 here is it's a community that's in flux. It's been traditionally African American. Right now we have a period where there's a large influx of sort of young professionals, folks who are around my age, who are moving into the community at a very rapid pace. And it is making for things to be quite interesting. And I think it's a helpful thing to have someone of my age group to be involved in the community board because, the issues that are sort of at play right now are sort of the same issues that I can sort of help give awareness to and sort of bring that sort of experience to.
The Ugandan immigrant is not the only one who realizes the importance of having young blood on community boards. Brooklyn Borough President Marty Markowitz and Manhattan Borough President Scott Stringer have both made finding younger members for local community boards a recruitment priority this year. Their efforts have led to a handful of 20-somethings from different cultures and tax brackets to make a run at what used to be perceived as a place only for much older residents. The application process is quite straightforward. As long as you have significant interest in your district, whether you're a resident or business owner, or just simply work there, attend at least one board meeting, and then you'll be qualified to apply. The borough president handles all the applications and makes the nomination. Community board members serve one-year terms, and the cycle usually starts in April. So far, Bunkadeko has been on board for about 9 months.
It's interesting, to say the least. A lot of the meetings are pretty, sometimes they can get pretty heated, they can get pretty serious. But I think all in all, I think it's a great experience. And I would definitely encourage a lot of my peers to go out and join a community board wherever they live in the city. Because I think it's just a good experience just to get involved. I think that's at the heart of our democracy, but just in good essence, being a good neighbor.
He said he'd like to continue being useful to the board as long as possible. Meilin Huang for Independent Sources.
Seth, thanks for joining us on the show this evening.
Thanks for having me.
So let's just start with a general question. What are community boards, Seth, and how are they run?
Well, there are 59 community boards in New York City, and they are established by the Charter Review Commission of 1975. And they consist of, I think the limit is 50 members for each community board. And they are appointed by the borough president in each borough of New York City. They do have to consider 50% of the community board members as recommendations from city council members that are from that district. But I guess the primary mover on the community boards is typically the district manager, who is charged with carrying out the activities of the board.
Now, what exactly do these community boards do, just for the sake of, you know, informing our audience?
Basically, they are charged with offering a community viewpoint to land use issues in New York City, budgetary issues in New York City, and the carrying out of city services to the community. However, everything that the community boards do are advisory, and they are not mandatory, and they are not legally binding. So they are advisory committees for the most part.
What you just mentioned about community boards and their roles, would you say that this is a perfect way, like a microcosm of what the bigger city government looks like?
I don't know if I would view it as a microcosm, but it's a good question, because I think that they are part and parcel of some of the problems that big city governments face in trying to involve local communities. One of the big draws for the suburbs, which have, as you know, taken a lot of migrants from big city governments in the last several decades, is that suburban governments are fragmented in the sense that they offer local control through villages, through school district boards, through town level government. And in the big cities, they don't have that. So there's been a very large effort in the past several decades to try and establish some kind of input, local control, if you will, while having the city council being the sole legal authority or governing authority in the large cities. So this is part and parcel of a much larger attempt to try and distribute, to disaggregate decision-making to local communities.
In light of all these decentralization of powers that you've just been mentioning, in this case with community boards, have community boards ever been like a jumping-off point for someone who may have started there and eventually become go into politics, become a outstanding politician?
For the most part, that hasn't been the case. Now, I will say that many of the community board members, especially the district managers, especially in certain boroughs, and I don't want to get too specific, but I would say the Bronx being one of them, there's been a great deal of conflict over the power that the local political powers, such as the borough president and the council members, have had in appointing board members. Now, board members serve for 2 years. They're appointed by the borough president. But there have been instances where a board member is not in tune with what a lot of the appointing officials have wanted from them, and they have moved to not reappoint them and to appoint people who would vote against them for the district manager election, which takes place within, you know, within the board itself.
So even at this point, you're saying, even at that level, you're saying that there's political wranglings.
Politics in many of the community boards has dominated. And in that instance, I think that you can say the community boards have been politicized to a certain degree. But I do want to say that out of the 59 community boards, there's a great deal of variation. There are some community boards that come up with excellent master plans for their community. Many of them contain very talented people, educated and lawyers and planners and engineers who are able to make very good plans that the City Planning Commission has had to really consider, you know, in their decision making. So they've been much more influential than some of the other boards, which are deemed to be lacking in that kind of skill. So there's a wide variety of effectiveness when you talk about community boards in New York City.
All right. Seth, we're going to have to leave the conversation here because they're telling me that we need to wrap it. Very good conversation, and maybe we'll continue in another time.
It's an important topic, and I hope we will. I appreciate you inviting me in.
All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Still to come, a trip back to the not-so-dark continent. Before that, Abby Ishola has some other news.
Thanks, Garry. Here's a look at some headlines from the ethnic and community media. From the Mott Haven Herald, a plan to educate Bronx residents on diabetes prevention might be getting the boot due to federal budget cuts. Health People, a nonprofit organization based in Mott Haven, trained 10 Bronx residents in outreach techniques to get other residents to adopt healthier lifestyles to prevent the disease. The organization initially received a grant from the Centers for Disease Control to train the team, but Health People founder and executive director, Chris Norwood, says they may not have the funding to complete the mission. The federal fund sequester forced the CDC to cut $200 million from nationwide preventative programs. Mott Haven has the second worst diabetes rate in New York City. Gotham Schools reports that the Department of Education doesn't provide printed school directories in various languages, making it difficult for immigrant parents. The language directories are only available on the Department of Education's website in popular foreign languages, such as Arabic, Bengali, Chinese, French, Haitian Creole, and others. But many parents and immigrant activists say the digital versions are difficult to access. The DOE stopped printing the foreign language directories after the 2007-2008 school year. Voices of New York reports that local Mexican businesses have partnered on an initiative to raise money for hurricane relief in their homeland. The Mexican consulate in New York City announced the plan called A Dollar for Mexico, or Un Dólar para México. Over a dozen business owners were given a sealed container with a tracking number for the collection of the money. The goal is to raise at least $250,000 by October 18th. Over 100 people were killed after two hurricanes hit Mexico back-to-back in September. One of Nepal's prominent journalists is leading the way for news coverage in his growing community in America. Voices of New York profiled Kishore Panthi, editor-in-chief of the free Nepali language newspaper, Kasokas. The weekly, based in Jackson Heights, Queens, has a circulation of over 10,000 and serves the Nepalese diaspora in New York, Maryland, California, and other states. Since Nepal's civil war from 1996 to 2006, Panthi and many others relocated to the United States. In New York City alone, the Nepalese community nearly tripled from about 2,000 in year 2000 to over 5,000 in 2010. And finally, Harlem's very first tea shop is open for business. North Hatton reports that Serengeti Teas and Spices offers organic teas imported from Africa and South Asia. Karanda Martin, the owner of the shop, who is originally from Liberia, travels to different farms in Africa to socialize with farmers and handpick tea leaves and coffee beans he sells. His company also ships products to 16 five-star restaurants across Manhattan. He says he opened the shop because he wanted to show residents in Harlem that Africa is a tea-producing region. Those were just a few stories from the ethnic and community media. Independent Sources will be back right after this.
Thanks for staying tuned. Most Americans who are familiar with the Congo conjure up a vision of Robert Conrad's Heart of Darkness. But the Democratic Republic of Congo is not as foreboding and mysterious as Conrad's novel would have it. Chances are that your cell phone, your diamond ring, and your furniture all originated from the Congo soil. It's a land so rich in natural resources that it's called a scandal. Last summer, I set out to revisit the Congo 15 years after I covered the Civil War as a New York Times correspondent. The war was supposed to usher in a new era of prosperity by ridding the country of the brutal dictator Mobutu Sese Seko. Instead, the country is mired in a perpetual conflict. What I found this time around is a schizophrenic country that is on the one hand developing with buildings and roads sprouting up, but on the other, struggling with bad governance that allows its borders to be poached almost at will by smaller neighbors. This, despite the UN's presence there to broker an elusive peace. The Congo, Africa's largest country, borders 9 states and is quite disjointed. There are few roads connecting the different provinces, and the best way of traveling throughout the country is by airplane, a luxury for the average Congolese. So, the abundance of natural resources, coupled with chronic bad governance, have left this large country vulnerable to talk of balkanization or breaking up the country in different pieces. This notion has been a rallying and unifying cry for Congolese of all backgrounds and is the subject of daily conversation in Kinshasa, the capital. Jacques Matenda joined me in our studio to talk about the Congo and the notion of balkanization. Matenda is a member of the human rights group Stop Congo Genocide. Jacques, I was recently in the Congo and I was in Kinshasa. I saw a lot of development. It seems like a country on the move. Is that true? Was I misguided?
Oh, you know, Kinshasa is the capital, but Kinshasa, the space that covers the Kinshasa is less than 1% of the Congolese territory. All over the country is the destruction. Mm-hmm. All the infrastructure are destroyed. Mm-hmm. All over the country. The social infrastructure, the economic infrastructure, the educational infrastructure, the medicine, you know, all are destroyed all over the country. And even in Kinshasa, they are building house, but they don't have water in the house. They don't have electricity in the house. In Kinshasa, even we have the electricity came from the dam of Inga. You see, it's a makeup. It's a, you know.
Now, why is that? I mean, this is a country that everyone knows is fabulously wealthy with natural resources. Why is the government unable to muster all that resources and develop the country? Instead, what we have is talk of breaking up the country, as they call it in the Congo, balkanization. Why is that?
You see, the problem we had in Congo, the governments, and mainly those who are ruling the government, are all the puppets, you know.
Puppets of whom?
From some foreign person, interested group, financial group, and even terrorist group from out of the country. You will see the former president of the parliament going to Iran with Ahmadinejad. You will see some of them be in touch with some interest group of Europe or from America, you know, and they are in power not because of the will of the Congolese people, but because of the will of those who are influencing the life of the country through the United Nations. You see, our country today is there because of the 20,000 soldiers of the United Nations. Those are the ones who are keeping the country as a country. Without the 2,000 soldiers of the United Nations.
2,000 or 20,000?
20,000.
Okay.
20,000. Without them, we cannot talk about Congo. Okay. And the United Nations is injecting more or less $1.5 billion of dollars every year for having what we have in Congo.
Talk a little bit more about the human rights situation in the Congo. Your organization, Stop Congolese Genocide, talks about that. Can you elaborate a little bit more?
52 Jewish rabbis that was supported by the Jews, World Congress, and more than 1,000 Jews organization. I was saying that those 52 Jews sent a petition saying that are happening now in Congo is similar to that the Jewish people suffer from Hitler and the Nazi.
Well, give me some examples. I mean, this is a country, as you know, it's vast. You said the capital, which is a large capital, large city, is one iota of the size of the country. So what are some of the human rights violations that we're seeing? Give us a sense of what they are.
You know, first, we don't have a rule of law in Congo. It's not a rule of law. And you will see the IRC, is an American
International Rescue Committee.
Yes. Uh-huh. In the report they made in 1998, mm-hmm. they say that more than 5 million people was killed in Congo from 1996 to 1998. 5 million.
Was that during the war or was it after the war? I mean, how did these people, were they killed?
You know, the world is not only with the arm. The lack of peace can be without arm, you know. As soon as you have a state apparatus that are not providing the security to the person, you know, on the sanitary way, on the way they eat, and the police, and you have also the arm, you know, you find the arm everywhere, and you don't have law. Here in America, you know, they talk about arm, but you have a law that are trying to reglement how can you have a gun and so. But it's a jungle in Congo. So all those killings have as results the mass killing, the mass extermination of people in Congo, even worse than the one that happened in Iraq when United States went to put out Saddam Hussein because of the mass extermination of people. In Congo, we have more than that are happening in Iraq. We have more than that are happening in Syria. But we see President Obama, when something happened in Syria, we saw how he's reacting. But in Congo, they do nothing. Even President Obama, the African-American president, you see? That's going in Congo.
Now, let's talk about moving forward. What is the likely scenario? Can, with all this dysfunction we've discussed about the government, can anybody hold the Congo together?
You know, nobody can get the Congo together. The people of Congo, through the democracy, as we said, the democracy is the power of the people, by the people, for the people. So we have to go through to restore the rule of law. And one of the characteristics of the rule of law is the democracy through the election. And then we can move on. But the most important things in Congo come from the outside, you know. As I say, those interest groups, the financial, the terrorists and other, are doing what they can do for to have Congo in the disorder we have now. So each of them can do something. They know that as soon as we have the rule of law, those people cannot do, and they do their best for to keep silent all that are happening in Congo. The wars that are happening in Congo, the media don't talk about, you know. I thank you for having me today for the Congo Stop Congo Genocide organization. But the media don't take care of us because they want to keep that is happening in Congo shut down, you see.
Well, unfortunately, we have to leave the conversation here. Thank you very much, Jacques, for joining us.
We thank you for having us.
When we come back, adding some everyday magic to the mundane. Finally, a story of mirth and magic. A group of students from Hostos Community College are cast in a play loosely based on Shakespeare's The Tempest. Judith Escalona filed this report on their journey to Scotland.
It was the journey of a lifetime for these Hostos Community College students, traveling to Scotland to perform in the renowned arts festival known as the Edinburgh Festival Fringe. Ángel Morales is the director of Hostos Repertory Theater and a drama professor at the community college. He picked Rough Magic by Roberto Aguirre-Sacasa for the students to stage.
I thought that this would be an appropriate play to present at the festival in Scotland this year because the play doesn't require a set. It's easy to travel with. All the roles could be played by students.
What I burned was an old English dictionary. You know, the OED.
Rough Magic is a campy remake of Shakespeare's The Tempest. It draws as much from the Bard as it does from Spider-Man comics.
It's funny, it's very entertaining, but at the same time academic because it touches on Shakespeare, it has Shakespearean characters, and it takes place in New York City. So Prosperous Island becomes Manhattan. It's a superhero, like a sci-fi comic book adventure.
Playwright Aguirre-Sacasa once wrote for Marvel Comics. He also reworked the script for the troubled Broadway musical Spider-Man Turn Off the Dark. Rough Magic delivers The Tempest to contemporary students in a vernacular they understand, making it easier for them to perform.
Our productions combine the talents of beginning student actors, some experienced student actors who have taken the acting classes, or professional actors. So what the audiences here at Hostos see is a combination of talents from different ages and different backgrounds.
The thing about magic is, you mustn't try to control it. You must surrender to it, open yourself to it.
Maria Vassallo, who is majoring in dental hygiene, was originally a theater actress.
I love theater, I love acting, I love dancing, I love entertaining. But financially, it just wasn't really working out for me. After agreeing to do this project, you know, I remember walking down the streets in Manhattan thinking, am I in the Twilight Zone? What's going on? Why am I doing like almost a full circle?
Yeah, I'm just gonna call.
Ibrahim Rashid, a humanities major, has performed in 6 earlier Hostos productions, many of them award-winning.
Every production has gone to another and another level that I've been in. So maybe when I leave, and they can continue, and it can be even bigger than when I was here.
For the 2 leads and the other 9 cast and crew members, the experience at the Edinburgh Festival Fringe was a life-changing event. Some had never been outside of New York. Others had never flown on an airplane.
These kids from the Bronx are now in Scotland performing this play. It was just amazing. And the fact that Hostos doesn't have a theater department. So these students, they don't have any theater background except for me. Yeah, it was definitely, it transformed me into just Remembering who I am.
As a graduate student at New York University, Professor Morales dreamt of teaching and creating an exchange program for students to study abroad. He too found the trip to Edinburgh Festival Fringe transformative. Judith Escalona, Independent Sources.
That's our show this week. Thanks for staying tuned. Till next time, be independent-minded.